I'll introduce all of you now, and then maybe if we go through in turn. So firstly, we'll hear from Paul Taylor, who's the Group Chief Executive of FCC Environment. FCC is one of the larger waste and resource management companies in the UK. It's part of the FCC group. Secondly, we'll hear from Sarah Heald, who's the Director of Corporate Affairs and Investor Relations at Pennon Group. Pennon is a sort of FTSE 250 listed infrastructure company which owns both Viridor, the waste and resources company, and also South West Water and Bournemouth Water. Thirdly, we'll hear from Margaret Bates, who's a professor of sustainable waste management at University of Northampton, but also the president of the Chartered Institute for Waste Management. And finally, we will hear from James Murray, who's the founder and editor-in-chief of BusinessGreen, which is one of the sort of leading, well, be known to many of you, but one of the leading media outlets for energy and environment-related news. So, Paul, what do you make of the report? Where should we be going on this topic?
I think it's quite a thought-provoking report, actually. For an industry, and we're on the kind of delivery side of this, and turning policy into action. I think if an industry which is totally led by legislation, everything we do is target-driven. Whatever we set out to achieve has to meet a certain target. And the thought that the targets are a little bit misguided is quite an eye-opener, really. There are quite a few things in the report which give food for thought, I suppose. I mean, things like definitions of waste are so confused across different countries, even within the UK. I think CIWM did a report that did an analysis of recycling in Germany, which is one of the best recyclers in Europe, and they laud themselves for that. And if they reported the same way we do in the UK, their recycling level would be the same as ours. So it's so confusing here and really quite misguided, I suppose. The table that Richard put up on greenhouse gas emissions, I think, was a real eye-opener. And that throws some very fundamental things here in terms of our policy. You know, we recycle, and it's ingrained in people now for 20 years that you must recycle, you must do that. It's good for the environment. And there's a table there which has been within the Scottish Government in DEFRA, which says for the primary materials that we recycle, paper and card, it's not actually the best environmental outcome, which is a bombshell, really. And I think that just gives something that we should think about. I wonder really with the policymakers if because of the lead from Europe, if we've lost the ability to think for ourselves a little bit. And therefore, you know, this is an opportunity to stop and say, right, what should we be achieving here? And we should think about the outcomes we're trying to achieve. And I agree with what you said about environment, economic and social. And it seems as though that's just become lost. And therefore, it's an opportunity to stop and say, what should we do, therefore, that gives the best environment outcome alongside the best cost? So you can't ignore cost. The circular economy package ignores cost, recycle it at all cost. And that can't be right, and there has to be a balance against that. At the end of the day, waste, and it shouldn't be produced in the first place. That should be the starting point. But for the material that is produced, we've got to think maybe a little bit more holistic about how can we get the best value out of it. It's easy to say, let's get the best value out of it, but how do we actually achieve that? You mentioned, a good outcome for food waste, for organic waste, is anaerobic digestion. That's a good outcome. So produce the gas. Why can't we use the gas to fuel vehicles? Because we have a big air quality issue. It's probably a massive issue coming facing the country, is the dirty air in all the cities. And if you could design solutions where you produce gas from the waste and you fuel vehicles, that's got to be much better. And the waste then that you can't recycle, balance in economics, produce energy from it, because the country has an energy crisis facing us. And it just seems such a logical thing to do. So a great opportunity, start with a clean slate, and think about policy, that will give the best outcomes. I just hope, with the low profile that the environment has within the government at the minute, that we actually grasp the chance to do it, rather than take an easy option, which is just follow what we're told from the EU.
Thank you, Paul. Sarah.
Great, thank you, Rich. I'd just like to start as well by just commending Policy Exchange and FCC for the huge job of producing this report. At Pennon, we've been fortunate to be able to feed into it, and I think it very much fits with our view of the world as well. As Rich said at the beginning, Pennon, we are top of the FTSE 250. We are UK born and bred. We are an infrastructure player. We invest exclusively in environmental infrastructure. We've got South West Water, which is our largest asset, and our second largest asset is Viridor, which plays right across the waste hierarchy, as FCC does, everything from trying to encourage minimisation, reuse, on the education side, recycling, and then if we can't do those things, we get down to recovery. That's our preferred method. We've got a big energy from waste programme. And then obviously we've still got some residual landfill, as FCC does as well. So we invest billions of pounds in the UK in environmental infrastructure. We finance, we design, we build, we operate, we deliver those vital services to our local communities. And we've signalled our intent at Pennon to keep growing. But when it comes to further investment, I think that's what this is all about, is the two words we keep hearing: confusion, opportunity. How are we actually going to finance the next generation of environmental infrastructure in this country? And we really are at a point of inflection. My background is very much on that financing and funding side, looking at large infrastructure capital projects in the UK and how we secure investment either on the debt or equity side to go ahead and deliver those assets that we so desperately need. So that's really the lens through which I often look at things, and I think we need to get better at looking at things through that lens as a country, and that's why I think we'd welcome the industrial strategy and the focus on that in there. And what this really all about is about, I think for us, is there's two sides of it. There's the industry, which needs to step up and make a better case for itself as a waste sector and industry aligned with one voice, and then there's the government and everything that they need to do to commit to that sector that has a strong voice, to look forward with a vision for how we're going to deliver the next 25 years of infrastructure in this country, particularly in a post-Brexit environment. So I haven't been in the sector for anywhere near as long as Paul, but I just thought I'd just share some reflections that I've had, having also worked extensively in sort of transportation, mining, and other large capital intensive sectors. But I think one of the things I would say is that the waste sector has really been overlooked by the government for decades. And particularly in England, we've never really had a waste strategy. The interesting thing that came about through devolution was that we saw that Scotland and Wales decided to make real commitments to environmental targets that we've never really got to in England. Obviously, Wales and Scotland have still got some way to go with the targets that they've set, but in England, we are quite far behind. We very much relied upon the European Union to set targets, as Paul said, to set ambitions, to set out strategy, and we've sort of followed it, and there have been successes, but there have also been lots of places where those policies didn't really work so well for the UK, but we followed anyway. We really have been lacking that sort of UK waste strategy that's bespoke for Britain, that fits with what we need and what we're looking to deliver. And that hasn't been helped, as I touched upon, by, I think, the nature of our industry. Waste falls between three departments in government, which tells you probably all you need to know. You've got DCLG looking after the communities and local government. You've got BEIS looking after the sort of energy and industrial strategy side. And then you've also got DEFRA looking after the environment side. And obviously shifts in departments as well have made it rather confusing. And as an industry, we haven't always helped ourselves either on the company side, I don't think. We're very fragmented as an industry. Many voices, many trade associations, many aims and objectives. Some people die on a ditch over recycling, as Rich said. Others are more pragmatic, understanding the affordability challenge. So you've got that constant balance. What's affordable? What can we really deliver on the ground versus how we're going to actually invest for long term for resilience? And obviously in our business, you know, we're used to water. 25-year plans are the norm. No company would be able to turn around and tell you they don't have a 25-year plan. We refresh them every year. And so I think that would be something that would be very welcome on the waste management side as well. And I think, you know, the headline on the opportunity side is that now's the time to change. We're at a point of inflection. What an opportunity we have. The government setting out its industrial strategy. If we come forward as a waste sector and make a clear, articulated vision for what we're looking for, there's absolutely no reason I can see that we couldn't end up in there. And actually, the way the government said that they want to address it is to go sector by sector. At the moment, waste isn't in that industrial strategy. So we've got some work to do to get that in there. But this is a huge opportunity, and the time is now, particularly post-Brexit. And like Policy Exchange, like FCC, we do see Brexit as an opportunity. I think there are many in our sector who were quite reticent and quite nervous about the referendum. It's gone the way it's gone. We're all making the best of it. That's the only way forward. And we've got to see it as an opportunity now. And it is an opportunity to deliver that UK waste strategy, a strategy that is bespoke for Britain, that delivers what we want to see. And we must build on our successes, and there have been many. In lots of ways, waste has been a UK success story following those EU government targets. We've increased recycling, we've delivered energy recovery programs, we've got the consumer, we've got the householder interested in recycling and focused on recycling. As Rich alluded to, when we do our research, we know that the vast majority of people want to do the right thing. They want to put the right thing in the right bin. They just don't know or understand what they're supposed to be doing, and no wonder, because confusion, as we've said, is rife, and it's very difficult for people. So there's a lot of work that we need to do as a sector, and working hand in glove with the government to make sure that we can really deliver what we want to deliver. So a new ambitious model is required. 400 collection systems is obviously a nonsense. That's no good going forward. We want to see standardised collections. That's recommended in the report that FCC and Pollux put forward. And we think that would be a real positive. And we do need to balance this affordability versus long-term resilience challenge. We must speak and act on growth. We do need to grow. We need that investment. And we need that innovation that Rich has mentioned there to make sure that we can really deliver that resource efficiency, that productivity in our sector that's a little bit lacking, and the confidence to invest and the confidence to look at new ways of doing things and to innovate. And to do that, we need this framework, which will come from industry working with government. And that should be rooted in a plan as well. It fits very nicely with the plan to get Britain manufacturing again. And I think that's another area where perhaps the waste market has stalled a little bit, in as much as we've often seen ourselves as a sort of exclusive sector doing our own thing. We need to work much more closely with manufacturers. At Viridor, we've been working on that. I don't know if many of you have seen the coverage on an issue of black plastics. Food trays can't be recycled. Everybody thinks they can be. So we're working with a technology company to see how we can change the dyes in those plastics, working with manufacturers to try and change that product. So we need to move out of our sector as well and see how we can really influence the environment around us. I see Rich looking at me because I'm probably going over time, but I think just the headline from me would be there's lots of work to do, there's a huge opportunity, we've got to come together as a sector and speak with one voice, articulate our vision. If we do that, there is no reason not to believe that we can't be at the heart of that industrial strategy, which is where we need to be. We're a valuable sector, we're doing huge amounts of productivity investment already, and we need to do more of that. We've got 25 years of investment ahead of us to try and plan out, and we need to make sure we're an attractive sector, that people want to invest, and that we can encourage them to do that. And I would just say that I was very pleased to see Greg Clark speaking here at Policy Exchange earlier in the week, making that very point about delivering an industrial strategy that allows for long-term investment, long-term priorities and partnerships between private and public sector, because that is what this industry is all about, and we need to make sure that we're securing our future.
Great, thank you, Sarah. Margaret, over to you.
But we're not doing it in order. Totally threw me.
I'm in the wrong place.
Yeah, let's do that way. You're wrong. So I've structured my responses in order. So really starting off reuse. to be honest, I don't think it's a shock, with or without the figures, that reuse is a much better option than recycling in many cases. The trouble with waste prevention and reuse is it's a much harder message to get across, and we haven't got that message across, even to politicians. They'll refer to recycling something where they clearly mean reuse. It's much harder to measure, and so therefore a recycling target based on quantity rather than quality, which is unfortunately how we're going, is much easier. So we need to make sure that there's a better understanding of what waste prevention is and what reuse is, and that that's reflected in targets and in policy. I would disagree with the report in some ways about household waste recycling centres. Many household waste recycling centres have very, very good reuse centres, and in some cases what their main barrier is space. And, you know, policy can't create space, unfortunately, nor can it create money. CRWM's done some research recently looking at some great examples of reuse charities working in partnership with local authorities. It's available on our website if anyone hasn't seen it. And we're doing our best to try and encourage that. And I know that the reuse sector and the local authorities are investigating ways of tying in both the housing and social functions with the waste and resource functions of local authorities, demonstrating that holistic approach to reuse that we should be looking at. On product standards and eco-design, I think there's systems we've got that are subject to review that might be better than additional kite marks or further standards. I think we should be looking much more at clever application of extended producer responsibility. People who know me won't be surprised to hear that in particular, I think for electronics, we should be looking at individual producer responsibility. Producer responsibility should not just be about funding collection. It should be about the whole life cycle of a product. It should be making it last longer, making it upgradable, etc., etc. And having IPR means that the standard or the best in class evolves with the technology rather than being static. So we don't end up with a system now where you're looking at buying a fridge and it's an A++ or an A++. And you're thinking, hold on, how many pluses is it? What difference does that make to what I'm paying for? You just know that an A is the best, and you know anything below that might not be worth doing. On resource efficiency, really, yeah, it's a total no-brainer, but we don't seem to be able to get that no-brainer approach across to industry. We've had report after report showing how much business can save by low cost and no cost initiatives, but some businesses just don't do it. And to be honest, I don't think any of us really understand why. On recycling, as I said, you know, I think we're going to end up with targets. I'm not sure we've got the cleverest targets. I think we need to be very careful that those targets don't end up that we collect lots of crap. It's better to collect stuff that's what the reprocessors need. So we're collecting raw materials rather than stuff that costs us a lot of money and a lot of energy to reprocess. I think the consistency framework's a great way forward, but I'm loath to force local authorities to go down a route for that, particularly because I think a lot of householders see consistency as having the same colour bin. And I'd like to see where we would get the money to reinforce that and to get that message across. And that's also one of the problems with trying to encourage positive marketing and nudges from local authorities. Local authorities are really, really cash strapped. We've had recycling visibly since the 70s with bottle banks, but we've still got some people who don't see why they should. There's some people who don't understand what they should be doing, but there's some people who just don't see, why should I bother? I pay my council tax. And I think we should look at alternatives. I think we should incentivise good behaviour in waste the same way we incentivise good behaviours in energy, water, etc., etc. On energy from waste, I think it is absolutely ridiculous that we are exporting energetic resources, paying to export energetic resources, and then paying to import energy. I think that if we could explain that more to members of the public, they would be much more accepting. There have been a number of studies about how you could incentivise community buy-in, including one from Policy Connect several years ago. I think we need to have some, like you said, sort of fact sheets about some of the technologies. I think we need to be very careful about not being specific about enforcing one technology, but going for the most efficient technology. And if you look at the pattern of efficiency of thermal recovery systems in the UK, the efficiency has increased immensely, but still the public acceptance hasn't. So there are more anti-energy from waste campaign groups than there are proposed facilities. And we should be looking at a position where we're not arguing about the technology anymore. What we're looking at, is this the best place to put this thing? Is it the best for the community? Is that where the energy demand is? I mean, if you look at the continent, which we're often told, because it's true, often their plants are much more efficient because they build them where we can use the heat. If you build it in the middle of nowhere, you're not going to find people who can use the stuff locally. And I think that's a really important thing we need to consider. I think also when we're looking at the whole regime, we need to tighten it up because we've got clear evidence of waste crime. Clearly our current system enables criminals to exploit to the detriment of the environment and to legitimate operators. We need to review this and make sure that we make barriers to entry in the right place. In particular, I think waste carriers is frankly a farce. We've mentioned targets. I would agree with everything on targets, but let's make sure we've got something about quality put that as well. And as you mentioned, and I don't think anyone in the sector would ever disagree, that we need to have better data. We haven't got a clue what's happening in some areas. Some areas we have better data. We don't have a good enough picture of what's happening. We don't understand our material flows properly. We don't know what's happening to our resources. This means it's harder to manage and it gives another opportunity for waste crime. So one of the things I would recommend for that from a CIWM and personal opinion is that we need to look at making EDOC mandatory so that we have better data that's easy to access. So in summary, I think there's lots of opportunities and we need to be prepared. Government is massively stretched to deliver this. And I think anything we can do constructively to help and to make sure, because we are such a legislative driven sector, that the government doesn't decide to remove the legislation so we see an increase in crime and legitimate operators suffer alongside the environment would be great.
Thank you, Margaret. Finally, James Murray.
Hi, welcome everybody. First I must explain why I have this rather unwieldy laptop on my lap rather than a nice sheet of paper. There's two reasons. The truthful reason is I was working from home yesterday and don't have a printer. The post hoc reason is I once saw a speech years ago now by Dr. Saul Griffiths in the US, who is Professor Saul Griffiths, MacArthur Genius Award grant winner, literally probably the most intelligent man I've ever seen speak, looks like a mad scientist as well with big frizzy hair. Phenomenally interesting chap, and he once did a carbon footprint of his life and his family's life, like the most granular exercise that was ever done on the precise details of your carbon footprint. And he found, surprisingly, one of the biggest chunks of the pie chart was his newspapers and books. And he said one of the quickest ways he could reduce his carbon footprint was just getting all his magazine subscriptions, all his books on Kindle and moving to a more digitalised electronics existence. So you can believe that if you want. That's why I have my laptop here. I am helping the environment, not because I'm totally disorganised. The report, and actually that is obviously a very important point because the reuse is absolutely critical. It's the blind spot. It is ignored. The efficiency of the resources we use is disgraceful and we ignore it far too often and far too easily. The report has a huge amount to recommend it, and I'm not just saying that because I was invited to speak. The call to improve waste data quality is an obvious one. I really like the idea of a carbon-based metric. If we could clearly say this is the most climate-friendly option, and climate should be top of the list when we're looking at these issues because it is the existential crisis of our times. that would be hugely welcome and it would make decision making a lot easier. The proposal for beefing up household waste recycling centres is very much a good idea, as somebody who lives in Lewisham and finds it impossible to know how I should even get to the centre and then back, and there's just, you know, it's a very confusing, it's quite a daunting prospect. People don't do it because it just becomes such a hassle. So if you could make that easier and more accessible, that would definitely be a good thing. The recommendation to continue working with the EU on eco-design, I think, is crucial. It's a really, really strong policy that's had phenomenal progress in terms of energy saving and resource efficiency over the last 10 years. It's one of the shining lights of EU policy, too easily ignored again, so I think we should definitely continue to cooperate there. The praise for NISP is welcome as well. It hasn't been mentioned today, but a really good project that should be expanded. Common packaging labelling is just blindingly obvious, and tackling confusion over recyclability is also a must. It's still too difficult. Everyone in this room gets it, because we work in this sector. 99% of people outside just look at things every day and go, this bin, that bin, this bin, that one. And there's no real understanding of how this stuff works. There's also two extremely good ideas that really do need to happen. One is a clear timeline, timetable. I think, actually, I noticed it was a timetable in the report. You used deadline today, which is a much stronger word, and I like that a lot. It should be a deadline for moving to 3 standardised recycling systems across the UK. 400 systems is just ridiculous. I mean, somebody has to have the backbone to take the case to councils and win it, and back it with the money, because you're right, they don't have the money to do it. So give them the money to do it, and it will save money in the long run. And the renewed focus on energy from waste is vital, and in particular within that green gas. Heat is the hardest part to decarbonise of the energy system. Green gas is a really exciting area. There's some phenomenal work going on. We have a fantastic science base in biochemistry and understanding of how this stuff could work. There's export opportunities here. We could become leaders in green gas globally if there was just the focus and the willingness to drive that forward. So I really think there's got to be a lot more focus on that. However, as a journalist, I recognise looking for a news hook and a well-spun lead when you see it. The title of the report and the focus on, I think, the EU is arguably a little bit misleading. There's a lot of stuff in here that has very little to do with the EU, and we could have been doing it anyway, and we should have been doing it anyway. So I applaud Richard for spotting the news hook and the way to grab policymakers' interest, but there's a lot in here that we shouldn't be blaming Brussels at all, and we should be looking to ourselves. I'd agree there's some problems with the EU in way waste and recycling is measured, although I'd argue that's been more than offset by the fact that the EU's push on this has given us a policy focus and has made ministers who would otherwise have completely ignored this sector — they do their best to ignore it now, but they would completely ignore it if it wasn't for Brussels giving them that push. So maybe we can take a little bit of inaccuracy in some of the targets and some issues there. It's also important to note that, you know, in UK lags behind a lot of other EU countries still. And even within that, even if we accept that there might be some issues with the way we're measuring that data, England is lagging far behind Scotland and Wales. So there are ways of doing this better that we are just simply not engaging with. When we wrote up the story on this report, as every good journalist likes to have two point of views, I asked one of Richard's peers at another policy think tank to put their view, and they said, the main problem — there's deeply confusing, contradictory recycling collection. Sorry, this is Dustin Benton from Green Alliance — is mainly because local authorities have opted not to cooperate with each other. In contrast, other EU countries like Belgium make producers pay for a larger share of collection costs, give control over to collections, and that's resulted in a more harmonised system. So there's nothing to stop us doing this stuff now. It's not the EU's fault we have a staggering, disjointed system, and it's not the EU's fault we haven't had a decent waste strategy since 2011, and that wasn't even that decent. I mean, I couldn't find anyone in the industry who had a good word to say about the 2011 waste strategy. It was seen as underpowered and weak, and that's the most recent one we've had. We've had nothing since. Just to iterate that point, I was at a conference, I think Rory Stewart was speaking when he was waste minister. He was there 1 year, and he did his stick where he came in and said, I want to hear from you, tell me your problems, tell me your issues. A year later, he came in and said, I want to hear your problems, tell me your issues. Nothing had moved on in a year. It was, you know, it was pretty poor, actually. I mean, he's a very impressive guy, but it was a pretty poor performance on that front. So Brexit could provide us with an opportunity, but the EU isn't really stopping us doing a lot of this stuff now. And I'd just like to end by making two very crucial points, political points, because we haven't really talked at the politics. This is all kind of a policy debate in a perfect world. Mm-hmm. And I think the last 12 months prove anything. We are not in a perfect world, far from it. So there's two political realities here. One is that Brexit is not solely determined by what the UK wants. There are 27 other actors in this. There are rumours, and they're pretty well sourced, that the environment will be a red line for the Brussels negotiating team. If we want a trade deal with the EU, and it is our biggest market, and please do not believe the wreckers who say we can just crash out into WTO rules and everything will be fine, if we want a trade deal, they are likely to say, right, take the environmental regulations basically as a lump sum. Now, that's a distinct possibility. That will almost certainly be the starting point for these negotiations. Is the government going to die in a ditch when the alternative is tailbacks on the A2 from Dover to the Dartford Tunnel over these environmental issues that we're broadly signed up to anyway, that we quite welcome and we're quite established with? Boris doesn't know what the circular economy is. Neither does David Davis or Liam Fox. They probably think it's about tyres. You know, there is no great desire to really potentially die in a ditch over this stuff when the prize is the trade deal that we desperately need. So there is a possibility that for all this, we might end up getting some tweaks here and there, but having to take the large pack of bulk of this anyway to get the trade deal that, again, is very much the economically most desirable outcome for the UK as a whole. So there's that political point to remember. The other political point, which I think is absolutely critical for anyone who gives the slightest care about the green economy, is don't underestimate the political pressure that's going to come on if we do leave under whatever circumstance, whether it's with a trade deal or without a trade deal. You know, the political pressure that's going to come on to just tear up any policy that has the faintest indication of environmental responsibility or green issues. I won't read them all now, but just after the vote was came, the Sun had a wonderful piece called 10 Ways to Say Up Yours to EU. 7 of the 10 were environmentally focused. The other 3 were getting the right colour on our passports back, something to do with tea bags, and this is my personal favourite, reclaim jam, as the EU says less than 60% sugar means it's a fruit spread. So those are the top 10 from the Sun. I know it's easy to mock the Sun, and that means that we should. But, you know, the others were things like defend our morning tea on toast by using appliances free of energy constraints. You know, actually push up consumers' bills, push up carbon emissions. And these are the top 10. These are the best they've got for reasons to leave the EU. I mean, I'll get angry, but, you know, it's staggeringly bad. There is going to be a concerted and organised campaign, it's already underway, to ensure we don't just crash out of the EU, but we do so in a way that tears up virtually every environmental protection we have and turns the UK into a low-regulation pollutocracy. That is the game plan of some of the people who are behind the Brexit push. Do not doubt that for a second. So I really hope we do seize the opportunity of Brexit to deliver on a lot of the recommendations put forward by Policy Exchange and others. I really hope that we strengthen the existing circular economy package if we keep it, or if we don't keep it, come up with some really great, better ideas to improve things. Because the alternative, and it is the alternative that some people are pursuing, is landfill, ACT standards, unregulated incinerators. It's really not worth thinking about. So please do be all on your mettle as this debate unfolds. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Thank you for the pushback. I don't disagree with the point that we could do some of this anyway. That's absolutely correct. I mean, there's a sort of almost 2 levels of that, that there is some stuff that we... Household waste collections, absolutely. Yeah. Like, how we've got to where we are is good. I don't really understand how we've got to where we are, but we certainly could have changed that already.
And that's the single biggest one. That's the one that I think would have the biggest impact if we got it right.
It could well do, although don't forget that the household waste is only sort of 10-11% of all waste. So actually there's an awful lot of other stuff that needs to be done as well. And for me, it's the refocusing. A lot of this is about the language. The language of circular economy I find entirely nebulous. The language of resource productivity, use less resource, get more value out of your waste, is that is something I think that most businesses can understand and buy into. So a lot of this to me is about getting the language right and engaging businesses. I'm just going to ask two questions and ask any of the panel to respond if they wish, and then let's just throw it open to the floor. One is about capacity within DEFRA to do any of the things that any of us have said, because DEFRA, I don't know how many staff DEFRA has, but they've got an awful lot of stuff to do, in theory. They've got air pollution, they've got water, they've got waste, they've got the CAP reform, they've got fisheries, you know, and a whole load of other things. They've got fewer and fewer staff. so is the Environment Agency. Like, do they have any actual capacity to do any of this stuff and do some original thinking? That's kind of number one. My other question would be around the point, I think it was something you said, Margaret, but we talk a lot about resource productivity, resource efficiency, and I talk about it in the report as well. And you said, well, businesses just don't actually do it for whatever reason. And there's a sort of, there's this bit of disconnect that lots of people like Accenture run around writing reports about how much energy and resources everyone could save, but people don't actually go out and do it. And why is that? And who can unlock that and try and make it work a bit better? So I don't know, who would like to respond to either of those questions or both? Sarah?
I would happily respond to the first one, which I actually violently agree that we could be doing a lot of these things already. But I think the point that I would make is that the industrial strategy is the big opportunity. Because, as I said, we fall between three departments at the moment in the waste sector. DEFRA on the environment side, sure, but BEIS as well in terms of industrial strategy and energy, and then of course DCLG in terms of local authorities, which we can't underestimate the importance of that. I mean, that is huge, that's where the contracts come from. And for me, the great opportunity for the industrial strategy is that that sort of comes above all of that as an umbrella. It's got the focus of the Prime Minister in her office, of the entire cabinet, you've got Treasury involved. And to me, that's where extra resource has been deployed. So if you can, and they've said they're going to do a sector strategy. So to my mind, if you can get waste in as one of the sectors, you're going to get the resource that we so sorely need, that we are so often overlooked for.
Is waste a sector, or is it a horizontal, everyone should do it thing?
I mean, that is a good question. I don't know if Margaret...
As far as the National Infrastructure Commission are concerned, it's a sector. It's one of their key sectors. But because energy is water is, but then of course you've got the massive crossover with water and energy, as you would probably be aware.
Yes, works well for us.
The trouble with the question with DEFRA is there's a lot of skills and a lot of expertise in DEFRA, but there are massive demands on their time.
Yeah.
So it really depends what the politicians prioritise to them, I would say.
Because to me they seem torn between continuing to implement or talk to the Commission about the circular economy package and at the same time coming up with something different. And it's the same with air pollution and all sorts of other policy areas. There's a sort of, let's carry on the treadmill of sort of talking to the Commission and implementing, transposing directives that they come up with in the next 2 years, and at the same time thinking about what happens beyond 2019.
But you can't underestimate how stretched they are.
Oh, totally.
I mean, the project they are engaged on. I mean, Dominic Cummings, the mastermind of Vote Leave, admitted it's the biggest project since we won the Second World War. He also believes that Whitehall capacity is absolutely terrible. So I don't quite know how he marries those two positions, but they are under immense pressure, and it will be political firefighting. So if you're DEFRA, the big blaring alarms on the horizon are the farmers and the fishermen, because they're the ones that are going to get you on the front page of the Daily Mail getting a kicking. So is there enough resource? There's absolutely not. And just very quickly on the more positive side, in answer to your second question, that it's not filtering through, it is starting to. If you look at what the big blue chips are doing, you know, Unilever's now zero waste across virtually all its operations. Walmart are going to every single major supplier and giving them best practices for energy, water and waste use. So we are kind of seeing the blue chip brands that set the big global business trends really embracing this stuff. And one thing I think the waste sector would need to do is sort of emulate what's happened with the RE100 campaign to get businesses to go 100% renewable energy, or the science-based targets campaign that's got all these big blue chips going, we're going to have science-based greenhouse gas targets, and actually try and do something on zero waste around that and get the companies that are all going zero waste to kind of get the profile boost that goes with it. And then you will start to see it filter down the chain from the Unilevers and the Nestles and the Walmarts and others. And Ford are doing a lot of work as well. Like, these are big brand names that are taking this stuff very seriously. So it's not moving as fast as it should, but there is some progress to be encouraged from the business side of things, definitely.
I would I just say two things to add to that? Lots of companies all doing saying there's zero waste to landfill. I would be surprised if any of them use the same definition of zero waste to landfill. And the second thing is, when we're talking about capacity, don't forget we're not just talking about England, we're talking about Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland as well.
Yes.
And they've got very different approaches. I mean, you know, you can't really miss the difference in approach Scotland are thinking of taking, can you? But that goes back to some of the devolved powers around waste and resources as well. And also when we're talking about the sector, it's really important when we're looking particularly at outwards facing communications. I mean, I'm talking from the Chartered Institution, by the way, of Waste Management, but we are there to represent waste and resources professionals because nobody working in our industry thinks they're just doing waste anymore. It's all about much better management of resources.
Or did you want to come in at all?
No, I suppose an observation in a way really is, you know, the biggest single contact between citizens and government is the refuse collection. Mm. Yet it somehow gets no traction within government, you know, and it just doesn't seem quite right. But there has to be a hook. And I think, to me, around gas and electric, because there's a need for the country, that has to be a hook there somewhere where you get it into the energy side and industry, and difficult to do. But definitely under-resourced, for sure.
Yeah. Okay, let's have some questions from the floor, and we'll just sort of carry on a little bit over past 10:30, but not too. I won't hold you too long. So there's a question from the lady on the front row.
My name's Gaynor Hartnell, and I'm from the Renewable Energy Association, and I welcome lots of messages in this. It's very exciting. I've got quite a few things to say, so I'll try and keep it really brief. On energy, on gas to grid, we've got 83 plants in the UK. We inject that gas into the grid, and a lot of it is starting to be used on transport, and I hope more will, because that's a very, very good win-win. I really like the messages on energy from waste. And one thing I think is, for me, where it all started to go wrong was when we first had the first landfill targets to reduce waste going to landfill. People just couldn't get planning permission to build energy from waste projects. The first thing that happened, they did this RDF. You could meet the first landfill directive target by just having waste sitting around, slowly drying out, and sort of making solid recovered fuel, RDF or whatever. And that was where it all started to go wrong. And so planning is a really important thing. And if we'd have done that in the first place, got this energy from waste capacity, we wouldn't be in this terrible situation. I really agree with you about exporting our resources and paying for it. Just a high level point. The thing is about energy from waste plant is that they get their economics kind of is more based on the amount of throughput energy waste going in that they can take on gate fees. And if that was reversed and they got more of their, you know, more of their raison d'etre, more of their economic case was based on the energy that they produced, you would have more efficient energy from waste plant built in the first place, because they'd be concentrating on getting all the energy out they could rather than getting as much throughput in terms of waste as they could.
No, that's interesting. Let's take a couple more questions and then maybe if we sort of discuss around all of them.
And of course it's renewable energy and it's, you know, that's good too.
But anyway, there was a question. Okay.
Sorry, it's a bit awkward. I'm also from the Renewable Energy Association. Mark Sunford. It was picked up there by James and again, Richard, you responded a bit there, the whole area of, well, what should we be doing at the EU level? And obviously the report is very critical and those criticisms were certainly valid. But I'd wonder if the panel would like to say a bit more about what we should be doing in the next 2 years on the EU level, whether we should be still engaging with the circular economy and what's going on there and making sure that it meets our ambitions as well when we leave, or whether we should, as kind of the report is semi-suggesting, walk away from it completely and just focus on our domestic policies.
We've got one more question and then we'll do the three in one go. We've got someone not from the Renewable Energy Association.
No. Martin Gray from Pennon. Really interested in what James and Sarah had to say from that external perspective to the industry. I guess it is all about connecting with government and I guess the language of government and the industrial strategy. But against that, is the way the industry currently represents itself to government through trade associations, etc., is that still fit for purpose?
Right, who would like to respond to any of those?
I'm happy to kick off.
Go on.
On the circular economy package, yes, I think we should still engage. I think we should negotiate it and join in the negotiations to make sure it's the best for Britain that it can be. But also that doesn't limit other things we can do outside that. So I think we should stay involved, but not just use it as a unique opportunity. On the way the industry represents itself, what's happening, that has changed dramatically in the last few years. I mean, you just need to look at, for example, the Resourcing the Future conference that is a joint conference between, and Pat's going to absolutely kill me if I miss anyone, CIWM, Resource Association, ESA and RAP. Is that right? Yes. So that is, you know, we're going to be in central London and we're going to be representing ourselves as a sector to industry. We have the TAG group, we have Waste and Resources UK. And actually what we're finding is government is communicating much more to us with those holistic groups. And we're becoming much smarter at focusing on the unified messages rather than on the other messages. Some of the other initiatives you're probably not aware of yet is we're looking at a unified approach to skills development as well. So there's other stuff coming on. So yes, I think we're getting much better at it.
I'd like to come back on the economics of energy recovery. So I completely agree that I can see why everyone would want to maximise the energy output, which of course is what we do. So at Pennon, we've got 12 plants, 8 in operation. We're constructing a further 4. I think the point I would make there and comes back to this investability of the sector, which I don't think can be underestimated. These plants are 25-year minimum life. In reality, they probably go for 40 to 50 years. And you're looking for investment into those. And historically, there have been lots of problems with people getting investment in smaller companies. Because what an investor's looking at there is, how secure is my investment? I'm going to put up a huge capital injection at the beginning. What are my returns going to look like over the life of that plant? And the reality is that what the gate fees allow you, if you've locked in the gate fees through the long-term contract, what you've done obviously is de-risked your investment and you've got people comfortable with investing that huge amount up front for a longer-term return. Energy is obviously commodity, so obviously you can be very smart on your hedging, but in reality, you know, we hedge out more than anyone I know, and that's up to 2020. But compared to your 25-year investment, that's still not a lot. And there's a lot of variability on commodity prices. So, you know, our investment case is very much predicated on 70% revenue from gate fees, 20 to 25% from power prices, and 5% from recovering metals out the other end. Any change in that mix would have a real impact on your cost of capital to finance a plant like that. I think you can't underestimate that. I think where I would say I agree on the DEFRA point, we need to get involved with BEIS, but that's where DCLG really comes into its own, because DCLG is obviously the department that's awarding contracts through local authorities, and they need to understand how important it is to protect that investment case if we're going to see the next generation of infrastructure coming through.
I just want to make actually both points, but particularly on the EU one. Yes, we absolutely should be continuing to engage as much as possible on the circular economy and other environmental issues, assuming they'll have us, because we again underestimate quite how much we've pissed people off, and we have a foreign secretary who goes around comparing his fellow negotiators to Nazi guards. So, you know, we're not working from a position of particularly strong goodwill here, and the environment should be seen as a massive opportunity to build some goodwill. So we should be going in there and saying, look, we want to continue to work with you on these shared problems, which environmental issues are, on energy and climate, on waste. And the other thing to remember is the UK has actually often been quite a strong progressive voice on a lot of the energy and climate and waste stuff as well. So there are countries that would miss us when we do go in respect of this one part of the agenda. So a government that was really thinking about the national interest and not being run scared of the Daily Mail would be using the areas where we actually have real potential goodwill and trying to continue to work very closely with the EU to to get some positive feedback, so that when it comes to the really difficult, crunchy stuff we've got to talk about, we're not doing it from a position where we're just completely hated. And unfortunately, we have a government that is being run by the Daily Mail, but that's besides the point.
I thought it was the Sun, James.
Well, is there a difference? And the other thing on the connection with government, I mean, the waste industry does have this real challenge, because ultimately we are talking about rubbish, and people do think
or
of it as something, or litter, some, you know, things that are smelly and horrible. So there is a difficulty there. The one thing I would recommend, though, is look at what the auto industry's done in its engagement with government. It's become the poster child, and it's done, you know, it was a basket case 10 years ago, and it's become the poster child so effectively, with really unified positions from across the industry as a whole, no one slagging each other off, working very cleverly together, and an absolute laser-like focus on innovation, jobs and exports. And when the whole Brexit thing's done, that's the only narrative that's going to matter: innovation, jobs and exports. And there's real potential here. I know it has that difficulty of people's image of waste, but there's some really exciting stuff going on in bio-waste and bioenergy, in recovery, in recycling. You know, the image of the industry 20 years ago is completely outdated. So if you need that unified narrative that can go to ministers and say, right, we're cutting edge, we're innovative, and we will be driving exports, because that's the only thing that's going to really get their attention until things go wrong. But
I think we have to engage with the EU. I think the first thing the government needs to do is to confirm the targets that sit at the minute and what are being adopted. Because the big difficulty we have here is that if we want to take all the opportunities that we're talking about, we need to invest. And you're talking hundreds of millions of pounds of investment, and uncertainty will kill the investment. So the government needs to say, this is what we're doing today. The challenge is, what are the targets going to be going forward? And it's just a hard, practical fact. And the difference between a 50% recycling level and a 70% recycling level is the difference between, yes, I will invest in energy infrastructure, or I won't. And it's very simple. And we need to get that certainty as quickly as possible. So very quickly, confirm the current targets, and then very quickly say, what are they going to be in the future? And then investment will follow.